Hello, YouTube. I have the Sharp RD428UA dictation type cassette tape recorder. I'm sure you want to see all about me, but before we take a look at all of my features, here's something I think you will find very entertaining. Continue watching the video. I'll be back. ClydeSight is going to reveal all the mysteries about me. There were many things that were put wrong with me that had to be repaired, and ClydeSight did a great job, and I am now in tip-top shape. So continue watching the video and enjoy learning all about me, the Sharp RD428UA dictation type cassette tape recorder.
If we look on the front part of the machine, we see that we have a meter, and we have a microphone, and it's a built-in microphone which is very well shielded, and we see some inputs and outputs. There's an earphone output, a mic input, and a remote control input. We also have an input for a DC adapter, 6 volts. On the bottom we see the battery case, and there's a little switch here that you pull, and the whole case will come out like that, and the batteries sit in the compartment. And it just simply slides in, locks down, and there you go. There's nothing really on the back except the carry strap here. And on the top, we'll look at the controls. And what we have here is a play button, a record button. Now, to make a recording, you have to push them both down together. There's an eject button that opens the cassette door. And then there's a lever here. And the lever, if you push it down, it stops the machine. If you push it this way, it will do rewind. If you push it this way, it will do fast forward. And here is the volume control. On the back, we have a nice grill for a speaker here, and of course the badge that tells you all about this machine. Now, I've seen these machines marketed under different names besides Sharp. I've seen them under GE, I think, and Westinghouse also. So it was a popular design at the time. And to put the cassette in, you push the eject button here, and the door will pop open. And you can see there's the cassette well with the capstan and so on. And we're going to take a look at the inside of the machine and to see how it works, because this is a repair job that I got. Somebody hired me to do this, and the machine is a very well-designed machine, but the problems that it had were due to its age. Now, this is basically used for dictation, but it is capable, actually, of recording and playing music. And we're going to do a little bit of a sample of that right now. I set up my little Yamaha PSS-80 Portasound keyboard because I use the demo song here to make recordings on tape recorders. It is copyright free, so I don't have any problems with the content ID system on YouTube. So, we'll load in the tape. So the tape is loaded in, and I'm just going to put the machine right here so that it is able to record when I push the button. So I push down the record and play buttons together. Okay, that's enough of that. Now I push the stop button, and you could hear that the record play button snapped up. And now we'll do a little bit of a rewind. So let's take a look at how this rewinds. For that, we just push this lever here. Whoops, I wanted to fast forward. Wait a minute. No, I went into rewind, that's right. So let's hear this play back the Porter sound. So it recorded my saying, that's enough of that. The interesting thing about this is if you listen to this and listen back again to the Yamaha, this actually picked up certain tones in the Yamaha that the Yamaha speaker itself was not providing. This is a very good quality machine. And even though it's not really designed for music, it does handle it pretty well. And it certainly handles voice very well. So, let's take a look at the inside of this machine and find out what I had to do to get it back into the nice tip-top shape that it's in now. We're looking at the underside of the Sharp cassette recorder, and it is a fairly standard 1960s type design. We have a motor located here, and it's a very small motor, with a brass pulley, and it feeds the capstan flywheel here through this belt. And this is the friction clutch mechanism for the take-up table. The capstan flywheel is much larger than what we see here, and in order to see that, I'm going to have to zoom in. Looking very carefully now, you can see that the capstan flywheel has two pulleys on it. It has this upper pulley for the main drive, and then this is the actual flywheel plate here. And this has a groove in it which runs a belt which is just barely visible right here that I'm pointing to. That belt manages the rewind and fast-forward idler mechanism. There is also, on the back here, an adjustable screw plate which manages the back bearing for the capstan flywheel. And the back bearing is fairly tight because this machine is designed to be held in many different positions and work exactly the same way, regardless of the position in which it is held. Now, this capstan had a serious problem in it. That is the bearing that they used for it, which I cannot show you in the video. I'd have to take the whole thing apart. The bearing is made of plastic, not bronze or brass. And it is a bizarre kind of bearing because it was made of a plastic piece which had a square shaft cut in it instead of a round one. I assume that they did that to reduce friction on the capstan shaft. The problem is that because of age and the way plastic deals with age, the bearing actually shrank slightly so that the hole that the capstan went through became larger, making the capstan wobble. And that made the sound of the machine absolutely terrible because it had so much flutter. When we flip this over, I'll show you how I took care of that. Now, we can see here that there's two circuit boards. There is a green circuit board here and a brown circuit board here. This brown circuit board is the speed control for the little motor, and it is a transistorized speed control. Here are the input-output jacks on a block. Here is the round meter, and here are the controls. The speaker is held in by a spring, and this is the actual amplifier board itself. Everything is quite tight on this machine. Now I can lift the speaker out just very carefully, and you can see just how tight everything is wired in there. We're obviously looking at the upper deck of the Sharp cassette recorder. Here is the very small motor that drives the system. Obviously this is the take-up spindle. This is the rewind and feed spindle. Here is the built-in condenser microphone, which is in a very nice rubber socket so that it doesn't pick up that much machine noise when it's operating. And here is the record button and the play button. And this is the control back here that manages the stop, fast forward, and rewind. Now, the problem that this machine had is the spindles themselves had warped because of the age of the plastic. I'm going to try and show you how that works. All cassette recorders in this time period had a spring-loaded interlocking tab that would interlock with the spokes of the cassette. If we look here at a cassette, you can see, obviously, you see the spokes there, and the spindle had to interlock with them and was on a spring that would snap up and down, causing it to always interlock with the cassette. And this is the same on both sides. The problem was that the plastic hub for this spindle cracked because of the pressure put on it by the top locking piece. As a result, the spindle could go down and then it would jam trying to come back up. And the same thing happened with this. So I had to repair that to get this working properly. The brake back here is an angled brake, and so you can see how it angles this way. So it has a tendency to push the tables up when it is engaged. Let's take a look at rewind. Now, rewind and fast forward is very much like you would expect from any 1960s tape recorder. In rewind, this idler here, which is always driven by a belt from the capstan flywheel that we looked at before, just simply engages the rubber tire and makes the system rewind. In fast forward, it engages an secondary idler, which has a rubber tire, and that rubber tire engages this rubber tire. And that is what makes it work. Why exactly this plastic is slightly red-coated, I do not know, but it is in good shape and it has plenty of grip, so there's no reason to worry about it. Here, what I had to do to fix this, because this was rattling in the shaft, was I found a washer that was exactly the size of the capstan shaft itself. As you can see, there's the shaft. And I glued it with epoxy on top of the bearing. And so there's an epoxy shell around it. So that's why it looks kind of funky. But it is perfectly functional. It's just kind of ugly. But that's about it. And it's the smoothest epoxying I could have done. As you can see, it's clear epoxy, so you can kind of see it's a little bit out of focus as I move this. There is no separate erase head on this machine that you would find in this place. Instead, it's a single combination record play erase head, and you can tell that from looking at the wiring. Here's for the record play and here's for the erase. So it's a little bit advanced from a 1960s tape recorder that you would expect to see. Here is the block, here is the speed control for the machine, and here is the external jack for the external power. And if we look here, here's the volume control and the two control buttons, and this is the lever that manages the stop, the fast forward, rewind. In the back here, this is the connector for the snap-in battery compartment.
Thank you for watching the video about me, the Sharp RD428UA dictation type cassette tape recorder. I hope you enjoyed seeing all about me and all of my secrets and all of the things that had to be repaired. Please continue watching ClydeSight channel on YouTube for more vintage tape recorder videos. Bye-bye, YouTube.